Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel and happy International Women's Day to all of the girls out there in academia. This video is going to be exploring sort of the reasons for and sort of the evidence for gender inequality in academia, particularly at the higher levels. I think this topic is really important, so even if you don't feel like this affects you, I still would recommend watching this video because I think it's important for everyone to be aware of these things, even if it isn't something that directly impacts you. So I really hope that this video is interesting and insightful and that you enjoy it. So I'm going to be taking a deep dive into some of the gender inequality in academia in Ireland specifically, obviously because that's where I'm from, but I think it's pretty similar in a lot of Europe as well as the United States and other countries as well. So I think it's worth investigating what it's like in your own country, but I wanted to look at what it's like for me in Ireland. This is coming from somebody who is a woman in a STEM-based PhD program. So I think naturally in this STEM area, there does tend to be even more of a gender inequality idea, but let's get into what I found out. So I think it's always important to look at the facts as much as you can, get down to like things that are from officially government organizations built around whatever it is that you're looking at. So I'm looking at the Higher Education Authority's National Review of Gender Equality in Irish Higher Education Institutes. And this is from June 2016. I don't know if this is just something that's only done every couple of years and then they put out some sort of plan, but I couldn't find anything more recent in terms of this big document. And also to mention, in the document, there isn't any mention of non-binary people or transgender people. It does only look at men and women, so I'm guessing that is people who have self-identified as men or women, but it doesn't look at non-binary or any other variants. So that's sort of an issue in itself, but this video is going to be looking at the discrepancies between men and women in the higher levels of academia. So one of the things to mention from the report, there's this really good infographic which explains a lot of the issues, I think, in a sense, in one particular go. So the first one is that since the first ever Irish university, there has never been a president of an Irish university that's been female. So that's a big problem because it means that the, I suppose, highest position in a university has never been achieved by a woman. And this is in a country where we have had female presidents of the country, but not as part of the academic presidency of a university. Now this has since changed because I know that last summer the University of Limerick had a female president. However, this was in the article I found, and again I couldn't find anything more recent, it did mention that she was there in an interim position. That seems to imply that they're looking for other people to fill that role. So whether there will be a woman in that position in the future, that's hard to know. And I don't know, maybe it's obviously I'm not aware of how this person is chosen, but I do feel that not having a sense of security, a job security for her, is not ideal given that this is now the first time somebody has been appointed that's been a woman. In institutes of technology, at least there have been female presidents. So currently there are 29% of the presidents of institutes of technology in Ireland are women, but only 15% total in history have been women. When we look at the academic staff, we can see that in terms of total numbers of academic staff, there is a 44% women, 56% men, which is not the worst in terms of a gap. It's definitely not fully balanced there, but I mean, it could be worse. However, when we look at the percentage of entry-level academics that are women versus men, we see that it shifts from what had been 44% total being women is now 52% are in the entry-level academic grade. And then naturally 48% of the entry-level academic positions are filled by men. When we get to the higher level, so this is academic professor positions, we have 19% are women and 81% are men. And that is sort of where the big problem lies. We have such a big gender difference here, at the higher levels that we don't have at the lower levels. So there is something blocking women from progressing into the higher levels of academic structures that is clearly evident in the number of people. When we look at non-academic staff, and this is actually something that's interesting to see as well, in universities we see a higher proportion of non-academic staff in the lowest paid positions are women, and in the highest paid positions there are more men than women, and that is 72% to 28% in both of those. So there's more women in the lower half of the pay scale and there's more men in the upper half of the pay scale, even in non-academic positions, even though overall there are more women working in the non-academic positions in universities in Ireland. Another really interesting thing that this points out is people's beliefs about whether there is gender inequality in universities. So there's an online survey as part of this infographic, and they show that 64% of women believe there is gender inequality at higher level institutions, whereas only 36% of men believe this. And this does sort of come down to the problem of people not being aware of issues that don't affect them. So I think naturally, because the gender inequality is more impactful for women, because it affects women, we're more aware of it. I think 64% is still relatively low, considering showing that there is 80% of the positions approximately for professors are occupied by men compared to 20% approximately for women. I think because it's such a big issue, it seems surprising to me that even 64% of women, I think, is still quite a low number, and 36% is definitely low. So I think it's really important, if you aren't being affected by this issue, to be more aware of it and see what you can do to make sure it doesn't continue happening. And I think it's the same sort of situation where it comes to issues of other minority groups who are occupying these positions, and it's important that even if you're not one of these groups, that you're still aware of this issue and seeing what can be done to fix this. So when looking at the reasons why we have this gender inequality at the higher levels of academia in Ireland, one particular quote from this is from the head of policy and strategic planning in the Higher Education Authority, Gemma Irvine, who says, "The reason why women are not to be found in the same proportion as men in the most senior positions is not because women are not talented or driven enough to fill these roles. It is because numerous factors within higher education institutes, conscious and unconscious, cultural and structural, mean that women face a number of barriers to progression which are not experienced to the same degree by their male colleagues. Systematic barriers in the organisation and culture within higher education institutes mean that talent alone is not always enough to guarantee success." They do have a really good section in here all about the different potential reasons, and like, these are a bit absurd in a sense when you read them, but in a way this is something that people obviously believe could be a reason, and it's worth looking at these reasons and sort of seeing what's there. So one of the reasons, and this one I think makes a bit more sense, is that historically there were not enough women in the career pipeline. So that would be, you know, that whole idea of you can't be what you can't see, and not having enough women in the career pipeline. And if this starts to increase and we start to have more women in the career pipeline, it means that women will naturally see this as an option for themselves, and then hopefully the numbers would naturally reach some sort of equilibrium. There is an assumption that naturally there will eventually be equal numbers of men and women based on the fact that things are becoming more equal, in a sense that we have women going to university, which wasn't the case obviously a long time ago. There are equal numbers of women and men going to university, so naturally there should be more people in those. Over time, you will naturally have equal proportions of men and women at the same higher level of these institutions, and that can be the same sort of thing for business. That the idea is, now that things for young women are a bit more equal in the sense that opportunities to go to university might be the same, that it should mean that there are going to be, in the long run, equal opportunities at higher levels of businesses or academia, for example. However, there is evidence to show that this is not the case. So the example given in this report is that in Sweden, in 1978, 68% of graduates were female. The idea being that if that's going to transpire long term into equal opportunities, then 32 years later, when these graduates should be at the height of their careers, there were actually only 17% of positions in higher level executive committees that were filled by women. And nowadays as well, only 23.8% of professor level positions in Sweden are filled by women. So even though they've had equality in terms of the proportion of graduates, even more so graduates being female, that hasn't transpired into an equality at the academic professor level. So not having enough women in the career pipeline doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to have this long-term effect of women moving up through the career path. What they're saying here is that even oversupplying women doesn't guarantee that we'll end up with women in these top level positions. Possible reason number two is that these women who are in the pipeline are not as ambitious as their male counterparts, so that's why their careers don't progress to the top of the career ladder. So this one, they've looked at how in business it's been shown that there is no difference in terms of ambition for women, it's more of a lack of confidence problem. And it's not a sense of confidence in your own abilities, rather than a lack of confidence that you will succeed in the environment that you're in. They've also talked about in this how there is a reluctance among women to apply for senior management positions, even when asked to do so, mainly because of a knowledge that they will be in the minority of whatever group they're in. So they don't want to be in a management position where they're working with only men. The reason being that you then feel like you're not going to succeed in that environment, and you don't want to be the token woman on the team who's just there to fill their gender requirements. And I think the same thing happens with minority groups as well, that you end up being just put on the team because of having a certain demographic. And a lot of people don't want to take on those positions because of the fact that it means you're possibly going to be outnumbered, and naturally there'll be a bit of tension there. I think what's interesting about this point as well is that they bring up the fact that in Ireland it was only brought into law in 1973 that you as a woman didn't have to leave your job once you got married. So it's less than 50 years since that's happened, which is just crazy to me that that was ever a thing. One thing that's really interesting again that was brought up by this was that they talk about how women are often deterred from going up into the higher levels of academia during their PhD studies. So that's why I feel like it's a really important video for me to make as somebody who's right in the middle of my PhD and not knowing yet what I want to do as in terms of career. The Royal Society of Chemistry show that there was a big change in career ambition among female doctoral students, that initially women are as likely as men to want to pursue an academic career but tend to become deterred during their PhD studies, and they were more likely than men to rethink their decision to enter a research career over the course of their PhD studies. So that means that there is something that happens during that time that causes you to lack confidence in the system rather than potentially confidence in yourself, and you end up rethinking your career goals because of what the experience you've had in the sort of academic system. So I just think that's something that's important to be aware of during your PhD studies. By the fact that this came out only a couple years ago, it's going to be interesting to see if this is the case. Then lastly, they have the idea of motherhood being part of career ambition, and sort of the idea that motherhood is incompatible with women's careers. They've shown that in terms of academic publication productivity, this hasn't been the case, but I know that this has been somewhat different in terms of COVID, so I'm gonna do a little section on that towards the end of the video, because obviously this was put out pre-COVID, and I think we need a little bit of an update of how academia is being impacted for women in COVID times. So essentially they found that the difference in level of ambition is more so to do with the external factors rather than a difference between men and women natural ambitions. Third possible reason that they cite is that progression is based on excellence and merit, and therefore these women must not be as good as the men, and naturally that means that that's why they end up not having careers. I think this obviously was just there as a way to make sure that there is no possible reason people can think this. So even just to show that this is not the case, there was a double blind experiment where they took CVs and changed the names to be more male-centered or female-centered in whichever case, and they found that in this fake essentially experiment, the faculty who were, you know, involved in the sort of hiring process or whatever it was rated the male applicants as significantly more competent than identical female applicants. They also offered a higher starting salary, and more career mentoring was offered to the male applicants. So that's great. The research essentially concluded there that interventions addressing faculty gender bias might advance the goal of increasing the participation of women in science. Yeah, I'd be inclined to agree. It's really disturbing that that even occurred. This was a study done by the National Academy of Sciences. I'm not sure where that is, but it's definitely an upsetting result. So it just shows that there is differential treatment of women, and in terms of salary, career opportunity, development, mentoring, as well as just general barriers to getting in. So it just means that everything builds up that sort of causes really big issues. And then lastly, they have possible reason number four, the structures for merit assessment, promotions and appointments used at various stages of the career ladder allow for differential treatment of women and men, resulting in a failure to retain and promote all of the best talent. So I think that's down to the sort of lack of transparency there is about a lot of ways to move up the career ladder in academia. So there's no clear path in place for why you get a certain promotion, why you get this or that. And I think that's even something that I've noticed there's sort of transparency about, because in my university there's two pay scales for demonstrators at postgraduate level, and there's no clear guidance as to when or why you would be given the higher pay. And that just leaves sort of room for speculation that this could happen. The next section of this video is sort of how COVID has impacted the sort of gender inequality for women in academia. And one sort of big thing is that since lockdowns and everything like that, the number of research papers and things like that being submitted to conferences and journals and whatnot for men has increased by 50%. So they've been able to take sort of this time, this quiet time, to work on more papers and things like that, which is amazing. But meanwhile, the number of first author papers by women has decreased dramatically. And a big reason for that has been childcare. Even though this is not necessarily one of the reasons why fewer women go into the higher levels of the academic circuit, it seems this has been something that has been more impactful now with COVID times, with, you know, homeschooling and everything like that. It seems that majoritarily women are taking the brunt of the homeschooling and childcare responsibilities in the household, while in many cases men and women are sharing, but in very few cases are men taking the sole responsibility for childcare and homeschooling. And that seems to have been leading to fewer research outputs for women, which can naturally over time lead to a big problem, since that is something that these research institutes value a lot. I don't know if there's going to be more studies done on this. Obviously COVID's something that's still going on, so maybe things will turn around, but it's definitely something to consider in all of this. And the last thing I wanted to talk about is my experience, since I'm a woman doing a STEM related PhD. I guess my experience in terms of gender inequality is that there definitely was, as I was going through my undergraduate and master's programs, there were fewer women in my programs or in my classes, let's say, for math, statistics, computer science, for my sort of science classes. There were definitely fewer women in those classes than men. So I would have thought that at the higher level, it would have continued in that way. And I definitely, you know, there is some level of inequality in terms of professors and things like that in the university. However, my PhD program was set up as 50% men and women, at least for my first year. And as well, the organizing committee, who sort of oversee the entire program, were also 50-50 men and women. And I think that's obviously something that has been very carefully done to ensure that there is that sense of belonging and feeling like that you fit in. And I think, you know, to ensure that this level of equality does continue on in the long run, and it obviously is with the sort of plans to ensure gender equality, and I think that's great. How does the experience sort of feel being one of these women? I think when you're involved in things where you know there's been a certain level of equality measures taken, for me that always puts in a certain level of doubt, because I know there were most likely more men than women applying for this program, and then that makes me have some doubts as to whether you got in because of your merit as a student and researcher, or because they're meeting their gender targets. I think at the same time, it's really important that that does happen, because it's important for future generations of people to have. But I think being somebody caught in the middle of this can be hard. And like, maybe that's not true. Maybe there did so happen to be half and half people applying. I don't know. But I have to say I doubt it, given the numbers in the sort of master level, let's say, computer science classes. I find it hard to believe that there would be 50-50. And yeah, I just think it is challenging, but necessary. And I think, you know, I think it is a hard thing because of needing these quotas to be filled. It means pretty much anytime I get anything, I always wonder if it's because of that or because I deserved it. And that's, yeah, it's just hard. So I think that's a confidence thing perhaps as well. And I think that always comes back to imposter syndrome, because of that level of lack of representation. As we were saying earlier, it sort of builds that culture of not belonging there and lack of trust in the fact that you will succeed because you don't see other people up at that high level. So, you know, that's why I do think it's important, if you are somebody in, you know, a group that is underrepresented in any way in your field or in your university, that you do get out there when you have the opportunity to be a front runner. And I do try to take on whatever opportunities I can in terms of putting myself forward as a face of something, even though it can be annoying and I don't love doing it. I think it's important. I think it has a long-term effect in terms of how it will impact people in the future. Can't be what you can't see. I think that's such a true statement. So I do hope that what I'm doing at the moment is leading to a better climate in the future, and that when I look back for International Women's Day in 5 years, that there has been a big shift. That is it for this video. I hope that it was interesting or entertaining somehow. I hope that you have a fab International Women's Day. Please do comment down below your experiences on these topics and your opinions. I'd love to hear them. Thank you so much for watching. Thanks to all of my wonderful members as always. And I will see you all in the next video.